Hey PC World fans, Adam here at the AMD booth at CES 2024 with Don. Don, please tell people who don't know what you do at AMD.
So hey there, I'm Donnie Wolgroski. I am the Technical Processor Marketing Manager for desktop and laptop consumer processors at AMD.
Okay, awesome. And we're here to talk about this new Ryzen 8000 APUs, the first AM5 APUs. We're also going to talk about AM4 a little bit later. But my very first question, I have to get this out of the way before we get into the details of this. What the hell took you so long? People have been waiting for new APUs forever.
Yeah. Man, that's really a business decision, honestly. I didn't make that personal decision.
But you're not the guy who's just waiting to let them
It was inevitable. We all knew it would come someday. It just probably was a little longer than most folks thought it would to get a true APU to AM5. I think a big piece of it is that every processor on AM5 is now an APU. They all have graphics built in.
True,
right?
So
there wasn't that, honestly, it's commercial. It usually drove that business.
Mm-hmm.
And so we didn't have to rush and come out with a bigger APU to service the commercial side, because they're really happy with the built-in Radeon graphics on Ryzen 7000.
Okay.
We kind of waited till it was the right time to come out with a more interesting solution. One with not only really powerful graphics, so the most powerful graphics you can get in a desktop processor, and graphics fast enough to play pretty much anything at 1080p, but also the very first NPU on a desktop processor. So having the neural network processor, that new IP, that new resource for developers to take advantage of, along with really the best out-of-box processor gaming experience that has ever been. I can't think of a different alternative.
I like it. Yeah, we're definitely going to get to the NPU, but there's four chips that were announced: the 8700G for 324, the 8600G for 299, the 8500G for 176, and the 8300G, which doesn't have a price. Why doesn't it have a price on it?
The 8300G, the Ryzen 3, is only for OEM systems, so it will not be available in a box. The other three models that you mentioned will be available in a box with a cooler.
With a cooler, okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's awesome. That's good to know. Because, so the whole idea around APUs is, you know, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it's a good entry point for people to get in.
Absolutely.
They get good graphics, but also have the availability to expand in the future if they want.
Exactly. As you're a computer guy, I'm sure you have family members come to you and say, I don't want to spend a lot. What's good? And like, if my nephew came up to me, I'd be like, this is what's good. Like, this is, your bases are covered. It's good CPU performance. Mm-hmm. It's good gaming performance. It's expandable. There's no reason you can't throw a 7900 XTX if you decide to become an enthusiast gamer. But you can get a great experience in every game out there. You can enjoy every game out there. And that's, you know, every time you can lower the barrier to entry for gamers, you really help expand the user base. You help, you know, developers can address more people with maybe more demanding games. So it's that great cycle we've seen since forever, right? And it's cool. I mean, DDR5 really opens up a lot higher, a different tier of graphics performance.
Yeah. Well, and I guess that's one of the questions I have, because you did announce some updates to AM4 based GPUs, Ryzen 5000, the 5600 GT and the 5500 GT. Mm-hmm. So a little updates there. Why would somebody go AM4 over AM5? Both at the same time?
Two really good reasons. First of all, we've got a massive install base, and we proved you could have a launch board with a Ryzen 1700X in it from, what is that now, 5 years ago?
Maybe longer than that.
and if there's a bias that update for that board, you can put in a 5800X3D and have something that's really cutting edge. So as long as those boards are out there, as long as there's still a market for DDR4, it just makes a lot of sense for us to keep supporting that market. And we're happy to do it.
Well, I would imagine it's also a platform cost kind of thing. So, I mean, especially
Absolutely.
If this is aimed at kind of newer builders, it would be cheaper to go for the AM4 version. But then why step up the, you know, pay a little bit more for that AM5?
I think the AM5 solution is for people who, you might not want to pay the most, mm-hmm. but you also want to be teed up for the future. Mm. And we totally proved with AM4 that you could keep a platform going for years and years and years. And a lot of people didn't think that was, and it certainly wasn't easy. And we learned a lot doing it. So we would like to do the same thing with AM5. And because of that, you should have a lot of confidence as a consumer that you can buy an entry-level AM5, not spend a ton of money, but have a platform that's going to grow with you, absolutely. You don't have to replace it every couple of years. And I think that's really great.
Well, in the materials during the presentation, you showed it up against a, oh God, what was it? A 13400F with a GTX 1650. Which, I mean, that combination is more expensive than AM5, but I mean, we'll have to do our own independent testing, but what you're showing is it's on par, or sometimes better.
Gaming's about on par, sometimes better, sometimes a little worse. Mm. From the CPU perspective, it's mostly better to have the 8700G. But once again, you look at the other pieces of it, your expandability, your future-proofness, your ability to just keep yourself current with this platform. It ends up being kind of a no-brainer if you take in all, from our perspective, if you take in all the different factors, it's just really cool to be able to have something that'll grow with you, that's bottom end, that'll go to the top end later. No reason you can't put a 7900 XTX into an 8700G system. Mm-hmm. And that's great. As you can see here, there's nothing in there.
Yep.
There's nothing in your way.
Running Starfield.
If you want to put a high-end graphics card in there.
Well, so one of the things with the AM4 based APUs was it was very reliant on DRAM. You know, the timing, dual channel versus single channel, things like that. Does that all still apply for the AM5?
Absolutely.
Versions?
So when you have an integrated GPU, you're relying entirely on the memory subsystem in the platform. Mm-hmm. That means your system RAM is going to be what's powering your GPU as well. And so two things are really important. First of all, dual channel RAM, absolute must.
Okay.
That's a huge bandwidth advantage. And
so don't skip on that. Even if you're entry level, don't skip on that.
You've got to have dual channel. And if you can, and it's not, I mean, 6000 is pretty cheap nowadays. If you can do dual channel 6000, you are going to hit those great frame rates and really playable performance. And that's definitely the way we would steer people.
Okay, and so the graphics in here are Radeon 700M.
Yes.
I think the top is what, 7800?
780M?
Yeah. I'm sorry, 780M. Yeah, so this is a known quantity. We've seen this in the mobile parts, correct? What are we seeing? Are there any benefits to having it in a socketable system like this versus, you know, in a mobile, like, thermally constrained system?
Sure. I mean, that's the difference. You have two things. You have a lot more power at your disposal. Mm-hmm. So these are 65-watt parts, so they can use more power. And power is pretty linear with graphics in these kind of parts. Mm. And like you were saying, you can thermally give yourself a lot more headroom, so you're not going to get constrained by hot temperatures in a laptop. So we did see a significantly better perf on the desktop just because of those things.
And like you talked about earlier, this desktop system has the first socketable desktop system with an NPU in it.
Correct.
Why is that important for AMD to have an NPU on the desktop?
Well, I mean, it's important in general because if we're pushing the whole market, the whole ecosystem towards a future of AI PCs, like everything else in PC hardware, it's chicken or egg. If you don't build the hardware, developers can't develop for it. So we were the first to laptops last year with an NPU. Now we're the first to desktops, x86 with an NPU. And you know, you're seeing the ecosystem, like everybody is always talking AI, and everybody can envision this future where your PC seamlessly can summarize things and set up travel for you and knows context about your life and can tailor everything to you and can generate images for you. And these extra resources, and it's not just the NPU, you have to have a good iGPU as well. Mm-hmm. Your CPU has to be capable. But all of this is part of that push. Hmm. And you're seeing, we announced last month, the next gen mobile will have, 40 to 50 TOPS, right? You know, like a lot of TOPS with just the NPU. And so all of this compute resource will get gobbled up as we go forward, just because AI is fairly demanding. Hmm. But it's exciting to see how it's actually changing the way we use our PCs, and that's Well, it's pretty cool.
It makes me think all the people who have non-APU-based Ryzen 8000 chips don't have an NPU. What's stopping you from having an NPU in those chips?
To be honest, it's just a... what's the word I'm looking for? You're trying to just address different parts of the market with different costs. It's a different die on the Ryzen 5 8500G and the 8300G, and that die just doesn't have an NPU on it. So to save costs and hit that market, we needed to take that out. I do believe the day is coming when everything will have an NPU. I think that's an inevitable future. But as we crawl forward and kind of find our way, I think these are the right parts at the right prices to kind of put us into the mainstream and give that user base that the developers need.
Okay. Well, I mean, but I also think about people who bought a 7950X3D, you know, one of the best, greatest top-of-the-line chips out there. They don't have an NPU.
That's true, but on desktop, NPU is less of a consideration right now because these NPUs, once again, they're about 16-ish tops, which is great, especially for laptops. The NPU was really designed as a efficient way to run AI workloads, so we can do things in less than a watt that you need tens of watts on a GPU.
Got it.
Now, on a desktop, you've got a lot of wattage to play with. You've got a problem. If you want to do AI, you can get a GPU.
True.
And you can get way more performance than you would on an NPU. The day is coming, I think, in the future, as we ramp up perf, like I said, 40 plus tops, where you're going to start to see the NPU cross over in performance to the GPU, but still delivering less power, like requiring less power. And I think then things get more interesting. And honestly, we have to kind of map this out and chart it out. Along with everybody, we're figuring out where's the most resources needed. Do we need to bolster up the NPU after that? Or is it more of an internal GPU bolstering? Or do we have to, you know, it's this constantly evolving discussion. And until we have the first, I think, you know, I'm looking forward to Windows, the next version, where maybe Copilot will be more integrated into your experience and can access those extra IPs. I think after that point, we'll know what we need. We'll have a better idea to make a roadmap.
Speaking of roadmaps, is it safe to say you want every CPU from mobile to desktop to have an NPU in it? Or do you think there's still some situations where it doesn't really matter?
I mean, like I said, in the case of desktop, in the near future, I don't know if there's a use case that you'd require an NPU, because GPUs in a desktop can be very powerful, very, very powerful AI tools.
True.
Having said that, that doesn't mean that the day won't come, right, when the NPU is intrinsically, you know, always used for this one use case.
Got it.
Might make a lot of sense. So.
Yeah. So before we get out of here, one of the other things I want to talk about is AM4. This thing refuses to die.
It does refuse to die.
Well, and my first question is AM4 holding back AM5 adoption, do you think? By having released four new AM4 chips, is this stopping people from adopting AM5 and going into the future?
I don't think that's a concern. Like, if that's the right product for you, then buy AM4. If you want, you know, the lowest cost DDR4 solution that still has great performance, I am so okay with you buying AM4. Go ahead. I mean, that's how we address the market, right? The competition put DDR4 on their next gen boards. We just kept the older stuff going and said, hey, this is a low cost basis. You can get these for dirt cheap. They still perform. X3D still really takes it to that next level. So why not have these things living together? We've all been through this cycle before of DDR, right? There's going to be a day when DDR5 gets way cheaper than DDR4. And then you're going to see those old platforms get less, you know, interest. But, man, people still have the interest, and we're super happy to service their needs. So.
It's just funny because I remember when the 5800X3D came out, even the video we did, we were like, oh, this is a swan song for AM4.
This is
probably the end. It's like, wait, hold on. They're still making AM4-based CPUs. How do you find that endpoint? Is it just RAM costs that you think, or hey, you know what, AM4, we're no longer gonna kind of push for it?
I think if you look traditionally, it tracks to RAM costs.
Oh, okay.
I think the moment that DDR5 is cheaper, why would you buy an AM4 system, right? Like I don't know if there's a good reason to do that.
Yeah.
There might be, if the CPUs are cheap enough, it still might offset it.
Right.
You might
be
like, okay, but I generally that's it. Or even availability, at a certain point, it just gets harder and harder to find
true,
that RAM.
True.
And so, but we're, once again, we're happy to keep it going as long as people want to buy it and as long as our partners make memory and
okay,
works for everybody. Nice. Everybody's happy.
Well, the 5600 X3D was microcenter only.
That's right.
The messaging, if I remember correctly, was like, hey, we have limited quantities. That's we're just going to seed it to, you know, a single vendor. This isn't the same thing that's happening with 5700 X3D, right?
That's absolutely true.
So it's going to be widely available. Yes. And actually, I mean, the cost of it is only a little bit more than a 5600 X3D.
Yeah, it's a
good
deal.
And you're getting more cores, things like that. Like, what's, why introduce this now when both, you got the 5800 X3D, which is, it drops down in price here and there, but then that 5600 X3D is also still around, I guess, if you can get to a microcenter.
Yeah, exactly.
I guess a better question for me is, like, is it because the people were angry that they couldn't get the 5600
no.
X3D that you're like,
no.
Okay, you know what? Let's do the 5700
X3D. A lot of this stuff, first of all, it's a business decision. We look at the market, see what people want, see what they're still buying. AM4 still strong, AM5 strong too. We're happy with that. Don't feel the need to yank the carpet out and say there's nothing more for you if we can do it. There's also other considerations in the business. Maybe they had a bunch of dies that they had, you know, kept for this use case that didn't materialize, or they changed their mind. And so the business use case is a big piece of it. So if we have the die and we can address the market and it's the right product, why not, right? So I think that's where we're at.
Okay, well, a lot of exciting stuff. I'm excited to test it. Thank you so much for chatting with me, Donnie. I really appreciate it. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Be sure to subscribe here on PC World for more PC hardware and software goodness from CES 2024. We'll see you in the next one.